Dear professors and guests, a very good afternoon to one and all. We are in the third day of our MPP program, Agriculture, Environment and Climate Change. We start the program with these words: if the plan doesn't work, change the plan, but never the goal. First of all, I would like to welcome Dr. S. Mohan Kumar sir, a director, Center for Biotechnology and Molecular Biology, Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, Coimbatore. Professor Dr. S. Mohan Kumar sir started his career at TNAU in 1988-89. He obtained his PhD in 1996 from TNAU Coimbatore and got postdoctoral training in molecular genetics under Rockefeller Foundation Rice Biotechnology Program in Virginia Tech, USA during 1999-2001. He served at TNAU in different positions for 30 years as teacher in the field of molecular entomology and biotechnology. He mentored 3 PhD and 22 MSc students. He has completed many externally funded like DPT, DST, AACAR projects as principal investigator sponsored by national and international agencies. His accomplishments include post-plant resistance, plant virus vector interactions, characterization of thrips and whitefly populations and their role in virus transmission, identification of DNA markers for marker assisted breeding in rice and vegetable crops, and development of BT brinjal resistant to shoot and food borer. He has also contributed to the field of insect taxonomy through DNA barcoding and molecular marker approaches, and characterized host associated and geographically varied insect populations. He coordinated multi-institutional research projects for molecular characterization of phosphine resistance in storage pests, which caused controlled failure in food grain storage. Novel microsatellite markers were also developed for rice weevil using next-generation sequencing technique. He wrote monograph on morphometry and phylogeography of honeybees and stingless bees in India. Let me cordially invite Professor Dr. S. Mohan Kumar sir to take over the session about recent trends in agriculture biotechnology. Sir, please.
Yes. Thank you very much. Good afternoon to everybody. First of all, I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share some of my views and the developments in the agriculture biotechnology in India and how it is progressing. And I also thank Dr. Muthuchelian for making this arrangement. And so the developments in agriculture biotechnology. Agriculture biotechnology comprises mainly the genetic improvement of the plants and how to win over the situation for the stresses, both biotic as well as the abiotic stresses, how the plants are able to withstand. And in the agriculture biotechnology, now the global scenario is around the very important aspect, and 5 countries are contributing much: US, Brazil, India, Argentina and Canada. And based on the crops, the 5 major crops occupying the major share for the biotech crops. So in that, the maize is leading, and also in the application, both herbicide resistance and the insect resistance are the traits which are used exponentially. And in that, the herbicide tolerance is the most important, largest market share. As like that, the technique wise, if you see that, the genetic engineering is the most important. And when we come to the Indian biotech industry, so it holds only 2% of the global biotech industry. So it is around 25,000 crores only. But the fast growth in the biopharma sector, everybody, we knew that we are in the COVID sector, and the RT-PCR based diagnostics as well as the vaccine development, the India playing a major role, and it is growing in a very high fast rate in the biopharma. Whereas in the bio-agri, it is only 15% of the share in the agri-biotech industry. And mainly the tissue culture, genetic engineering, now the gene editing and the molecular breeding, molecular diagnostics and genomics and bioinformatics are the major area and major technique. Lot of advancement occur to mitigate the biotic stress or abiotic stress, as well as to improve the nutrient use efficiency or improve the value of the crops by adding the value of biofortification, or to identify the valuable genes by bioprospecting, and also to develop the bio inputs like biofertilizer improvement or the biopesticide improvements like that. And major global biotech firms are many, multinationals like Corteva or Eurofins or BioCentury like that. There are many companies like that. The Indian biotech firms, mostly the seed companies, so it may be the Mahiko Seeds or Rasi Seeds or Metahelix like that. There are so many companies are there, and the clusters are present in India in the states of Maharashtra, Karnataka, Telangana, Gujarat, as well as in Tamil Nadu, in various cities like Bangalore, Hyderabad, Pune like that. And in that, most of them, they are concentrating on the improvement of the crop plants, because their seeds, hybrid seeds, are very valuable, and they are using the various type of biotech tools to improve the seed industry. And the government also have the growth in the biotechnology through the centers of excellence research, as well as catering the bioparks. And in the areas of agriculture biotechnology, mainly in crop biotechnology, if you see that a lot of omic studies are used, either it may be genomics, transcriptomics or proteomics or metabolomics, everything it is used for the associated traits for crop improvement, or you can use it for anther culture, tissue culture, as well as for the molecular diagnosis. And besides that, the microbial biotechnology is also an important area to improve the bioinoculant, to identify the super strains and to develop the novel process to develop. Earlier, they had the talc-based formulation. After that, they have switched over to the liquid-based formulation of biofertilizers, biopesticides, like that. The bioprospecting is also an important, it may be health. So they are using the prebiotics, probiotics, like that. There are a lot of applications of the agriculture biotechnology. Everybody knew about agriculture biotechnology, means immediately the tissue culture. So this is the major industry. Main focus is on banana. So now you know that the tissue culture banana is in the farmer's field in a larger area, especially the dwarf Cavendish banana. And the micropropagation is one of the methods of the tissue culture. Besides that, the anther culture as well as the embryo rescue technique are most important. So in the case of the micropropagation, if you see that the virus-free plantlets are produced, and the uniform quality and the same type of same time of harvest is possible with the help of the tissue culture, the banana. And in that, there are a lot of improvements in banana besides the dwarf Cavendish, that is the Grand 9 variety. Now the protocols are available for many of the other banana variety also. And besides that, the oil palm, date palm, as well as the pine tree, rubber tree. Besides that, the as said in the introduction, the eggplant, especially the brinjal, tomato, pineapple, like that. There are so many field crops, they have the micropropagation technologies. Besides that, the root crops like tapioca, sweet potato, and the ornamentals, they have the high export value, like orchids or anthurium, they have their good micropropagation. Many tissue culture companies in and around Hosur, Bangalore are having the high quality. And especially if you see that the Growmore Biotech, one of the DNA alumni, started, and they are now doing on the bamboo. So bamboo tissue culture is one of the important area. And besides that, the technique wise, if you see that the anther culture is an important technique. So with the help of the anthers, you are able to produce the doubled haploid lines. And with that, you are able to make a haploid plant and multiply into a diploid, or you can, it is a spontaneous one, or it may be treated with colchicin. Through that, the International Rice Research Institute, they are able to develop the salt tolerant varieties. So the technique is available, same kind. Now this technique is useful in all the vegetables and other crop plants, because haploid you can get it with the desirable traits, and then make it into a diploid so that it can be used for various crop improvement. So this is the diagrammatic representation of the anther culture. So the anthers are dissected and then put it in the medium. From that the callus are coming. So from that the entire plantlets are derived, and then the plants are able to cater the various type of traits. Same thing, embryo rescue. Some of the incompatible crosses. So if you want to crosses with a wild germplasm, so it is not possible to get a fertile progeny. So in that case, there is a chance for the abortion of the embryo. So to overcome that, they are able to use the embryo rescue technique. So they take the just newly formed embryo and they grow them in the lab conditions as we see it in the picture. So they, after the excision of the embryo, they will grow it in the MS medium, and from that it germinates. So protect them very well and then grow it in the primary hardening in the lab itself. Then the secondary hardening is done so that we are able to make a fertile progeny from the incompatible crosses also. So with this also in rice, there are a lot of examples. They are able to transfer them. So this is one of the technique available in various vegetable crops. Now they are able to do it with the embryo rescue technique. And if you just see the plant breeding milestone, starting from the initial selection until now the precision breeding, so it transforms into different areas. Few areas they are able to get help from the molecular tools. So those molecular tools are able to give the precise sources. So that tools are called the molecular crop breeding tools. So the molecular crop breeding tools, mainly the genetic resources are important. So it may be a primary gene pool, or it may be a secondary gene pool or tertiary gene pool. So within a species, if the resistant source or the trait is available, we can call it as primary. Whereas within the wild one, so if it is available, it is a secondary germplasm. And if it is not available in this pool, so you can get it from other organism and then transfer to the plant. So it is a tertiary. So the genetic resources are important, and how to make those resources, either by mutation or by various kind of transformation techniques. They are able to do a lot of genomic studies now and the phenomic study, and study the diversity and study their interaction in the environment and what type of trait they are inherited, whether it may be a single gene or multiple gene. So with all these things, now they have gone up to the area of, so if you are feeding the data of a particular phenotype or a genotype, is it possible to learn by the machines? And then, so if you train the machines to learn that, from that, is it possible to predict, compute the particular trait, whether is it present in a particular plant or not? So like that, the improvements are, this is a holistic view of the molecular crop breeding. So the precision breeding is possible. So in that, first aspect is the marker assisted selection. So with the help of the molecular markers, so they are able to know the specific trait which is present in a plant, and that particular plant, if it is a monogenic, so they can use the F2 population. So if it is a polygenic, then they are developing the first genetic mapping is done. Then they are seeing the flanking markers which are governing that particular trait, so that they are able to make the variation based on the markers without a phenotyping. So like that, just if you see that the doubled haploid lines, the mapping population in the first figure, so there are different types. So if you cross the two parents, you will get the F1. From that, you are able to get the F2. So that is the one population, important population. And from the F1 itself, if you are taking for the haploid breeding through the anther culture, so you are able to get the doubled haploid. Or if you are using the single seed descent method by taking one seed from each plant, and if you are improving it, you are able to get the F5 or F6, you are able to get the recombinant inbred lines. Whereas if you are going for the back cross breeding, you can go up to the BC2 or BC3, then self it, then you are getting the near isogenic line. Like that, the mapping populations are different, and from that you are able to identify a linkage map, and then see that with that map, is it possible to identify a plant with the help of a marker that flanking marker, if it is present, that trait may be F present. So like that, in this picture, if you see that, they are able to identify the QTLs which are responsible for the drought 1.1 and the 2.1 with the help of the microsatellite marker 472 and the 316 with the F2 progeny itself. Then we can go for making the selection based on the yield, etc. First, the trait can be done with this. So like that, they are able to cross various lines. TNAU is involved in so many crosses, and they are able to make the different lines with the help of the molecular markers. And the molecular based, the back cross breeding is most important because the target loci is selected and that gives for a particular trait. So within a short period or maybe reduced 2 to 3 years, you are able to accelerate the breeding process. So as I explained, so with the help of the BC2, then if you are selfing it, or BC3 if you are selfing it and see the presence of the flanking marker, and you are able to identify a good trait. So like that, a classical example is the QTL for the submergence tolerance is developed at Erie, and you can see that the plants are surviving that have the sub-1 locus. So they introgressed into various lines, this submergence locus, based on the molecular markers. So TNAU also did in CO43, and they introgressed that in the CO43 background and see that they are able to thrive. So this is a wild type 1, so they are not able to thrive, whereas with the sub-1, they are able to thrive that locus, so that they are able to get the locus from FR13A, and the introgression is able to do a good job of mitigating the submergence. Okay, just we can see here CO43 sub-1 and the FR13A. So with the CO43 background, they introduced into that, so that this was released by the Central Varietal Release Committee also. So already it is in the farmer's field. So if it is a single gene, we can go for a single locus like that. But if it is of a trait, is governed by multiple genes. So in that case, you have to identify the loci which are related to the quantitative traits, and based on that, so just you can select the diverse parent, you develop the mapping population, do the genotyping and phenotyping, identify the QTLs which are present in the linkage groups of the various chromosomes, and then you validate that QTL if how much percentage that trait loci is explained by the marker. So based on that, you can make it as a major QTL or minor QTL and then pyramid them to get the particular trait. So based on that, the marker assisted gene pyramiding is done. So if you are not able to follow, please stop me whenever. Okay, so the marker assisted gene pyramiding is done by the stepwise, by making the different kind of back crosses. So it can be done by the stepwise transfer, or it can be done by simultaneous transfer, taking the different parents P1 to P4, and then from that you can do the back crossing, or it may be done with the convergent transfer. So by making the F1, with that you can again go for the wild type, do the back crossing. After the back crossing, you can make the back crosses combined together. That can be also done. By that, now they have the population called magic population, that is called multi-parental advanced generation intercrosses. So in that case, so you are able to get 8 different parents and cross them. So the F1, again you cross them, so that you are able to get different traits are pyramided in a single line. So this is the important one. Simultaneously you can see the various characters. Besides that, along with the particular character, so if the yield is also good, you can promote them for the next level to release it as a variety. So this is a advancement in case of the marker assisted breeding. And besides that, the marker is not a gene, it is a marker is the particular place at which the gene may present, or the particular scaffold which gives that. So in this particular place, the trait is associated. So if the in that particular place, if it is very close to the gene or very less than 5 centimargon, so if you do the physical walking, you are able to get it a functional marker that is completely related to the gene. So in that case, a functional marker is more useful. It is a, the marker is present in the gene location. So we are calling it as a functional marker. So by association mapping also, you can identify the functional marker. So you select the diverse germplasm of 300 or 500 or thousands and do the genotyping and phenotyping. You associate them with the help of a population and see that how the marker is associated with the particular trait. So based on that, you clone the specific loci and identify the functional marker. So like that, there are different markers are used. So it was earlier started with the RFLP. The current marker is single nucleotide polymorphism. Most used marker is simple sequence repeat, that is the SSR marker. So with the help of the different mapping population, if you see that RILs or mutants or magic population, the reference set or core collection, there are different resources are available, diverse panel. You do the phenotyping, genotyping, then map the traits, and from that you are able to do the breeding. So like that, the genotyping and phenotyping are more important. So the markers associated with the traits are used, and many seed companies now routinely use their breeding program, the molecular marker associated with the various traits. So the classical examples for these molecular marker associated traits is the introgression of bacterial blight resistance. So there are so many genes. So in that, the XA5, XA13 or XA21 are primitive together, and then the bacterial blight resistance was used, and the same thing in rice, cassava and banana, they are able to increase the beta carotene content. As like that, the submergence tolerance, as we discussed, the sub-1 locus or saltol included with that. Same thing for the low phytate in the maize. So besides all these techniques, now the genome is characterized for various plants, various crops, or the genome sequencing is available. So in that case, they are able to associate the genomic information with the phenotypic information. So they are able to analyze the population. So they train a particular set. So this, if these markers are present, this phenotype is present. So if they predict that, they are initially, they make it a analysis, comparative analysis. So they are called the true breeding value and the genomic breeding value, that is the GEB. Based on the GEB value, they are able to say that, so this is the testing test, that data is correlated with that, and is it possible to predict the future. So this is the genome-wide selection, GWAS, and training population, the phenotype and the genotype. Now the SNP markers are used mainly, so they see the variations present in the single nucleotide, and they are able to do the genotyping, and in a one single chip, that is in an array, they are able to put 10,000 markers, 7,000 markers, like that. They are able to put it in a chip and see the, say, take the DNA of a particular plant and see that how the DNA-DNA hybridization occurs, and based on that, they are able to see which plant they can select it for a favorable trait. And besides the genotyping under the microscale, the phenotyping is also, or the field observations, that is the phenotyping. So whatever we are entering into the rice field or to any crop field, and it takes volume of time as well as the space for us to take the lot of data, and in those data it should be a precious one. So in that, is it possible to collect the data with the help of a machinery? So now they are able to do it with a different type of data sets, either it may be collected from the greenhouse or in the field with a different type of apparatus. So the high precision phenotyping or high throughput phenotyping facilities, now the laboratory scale IRI is having a very good system, as well as the ICRISAT is having a good system. So like that, the University of Adelaide in Australia, they are able to have the high throughput phenotyping. And now the drones are also used to do this precision phenotyping. So you can either keep the crop static and you allow the machines to record, or you keep the machine static in the first one, they allow the plant to move through the machine. So with the help of the different imaging technology, they are able to accumulate the data of various things. So it may be the leaf chlorophyll or the leaf area or leaf angle. There are so many types. In 3-day angle, you are able to take pictures, as like everybody knew about the pixels, how they are important and how much. So all data are compiled, and this is a very voluminous data. So the bioinformatic analysis is necessary to cull out the information from this biological information. So like this, the advances occurs in one type of breeding, that is the marker-assisted breeding. So that is also molecular crop breeding. Then the second aspect of the molecular crop breeding is through the genetic transformation. So in that, in the case of the conventional breeding, everybody, we knew that we make a cross and then we are able to see the progenies, select the progeny, self it, and then, or you can take a F1 itself for the hybrids and give it to the farmers for cultivation. Or you create a mutations by chemical mutagens or the physical mutagens, and from that you create a population, select the better progeny and use it for testing under the different environment, and then release it as a variety. Same thing, the protoplast fusion also done, and with that they are able to release. Whereas the after 1980s, they are able to do the genetic modification. So the transgenesis occurs. There is another process called cisgenesis. We will see one by one, transgenesis or cisgenesis or the genome editing. So the genome editing is the, for the last 5 years, it contributes very much. And this is also a future technology which has the edge over the transgenesis or cisgenesis. So what is the transgenesis? So this is done in case of the genetic engineering. So where the random integration of the transgene is done. So the based on that, for example, if the trait is not available in the primary germplasm or in the secondary germplasm, so we are able to take it from the tertiary germplasm and then insert it into the particular plant. So that will give either resistant to insect or to variable traits, like the golden rice for the higher beta carotene or the vitamin A. So like that, the only approved crop event in India is BT cotton. So which are against the 3 bollworms, American bollworm, pink bollworm, as well as the spotted bollworm. And with that, they are able to first introduce in 2002 in India with the help of the Cry1AC gene, that is the crystal protein gene, which are taken from the Bacillus thuringiensis. And this BT formulations are more important. And these proteins, crystal proteins, are able to cleave in the gut of the insect, and they are able to release the delta endotoxin. So because of that, the digestive system in the midgut epithelial cells are affected. So the cell membrane makes the pores. In the cell membrane, the pores are formed. The homeostasis is affected. So the larvae stop feeding. So once they take the crystal protein, so this reaction occurs so that the larvae are dying. So based on that, the biopesticides earlier available, so they develop the formulations. And from that formulation, they also recombine the different toxins for various type. So with that, they are able to make the transgenic crop expressing that toxin in the particular crop. So the from the microbe background, it entered into the plant background. So with the help of the selection of a particular event, so they took 15 years to develop this, and then they developed BT crops in various crops, either it may be maize, cotton, potato, soybean, rice, like that. There are so many crops, and in maize and cotton, there are so many events are also approved. And as I told, in India, cotton alone, so the BT crops are approved, and 95% of the cotton area in India are the covered with the help of a crop inserting this BT carton, that is the either with the, now mostly the staked one, Cry1AC as well as Cry2AB proteins, and around 125 lakh hectares are covered during the 1920 with the help of these BT proteins. So this is one of the very highly successful example. And so when we were the student, we are able to get lot of Helicore parmigera in cotton, and there are lot of damages, and most of the farmers spray for many rounds. But now if you see that the Helicore parmigera, collecting the Helicore parmigera in cotton itself is a problem, but other bollworms we will discuss. And next to that, so when we are releasing it 2002, now it is in 2020. So for the last 18 years, it yield very good. And among the three bollworms, all the three bollworms are controlled. Now slightly in Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh and Andhra Pradesh area, the resistance occurs for the pink bollworm. So the pink bollworm, everybody, if you know that their feeding place is, it is in the bolls. The interlocular burrowing is an important symptom. So when they feed on the seed, and in the F1 plant, when the seeds are there, three seeds are transgenic and one seed is non-transgenic. So in that case, there are some non-transgenic also. The larvae are able to survive in that. Now they are developing the IPM along with this BT toxin. So they are able to withstand this problem. Okay. And in TNA also, we have done a lot of research at CPMB, and we have more than 400 isolates, and we are able to get two patents, and 2AX1 and 2AI are major Cry proteins characterized. Besides that, the nematicidal proteins also characterized, and so we are able to develop well. Then same thing, this BT, there are different traits are adopted at the global scale. So 17 million farmers are using, and in that the 6 million farmers in India are using this BT cotton in 2018. Besides cotton, there are so many crops. So as we say that the brinjal is also developed in India, and but the approval is not given for at India, whereas in Bangladesh they already approved. So the it is also in cultivation. So like that, there are so many crops. So with the different traits, so they are adapted. So herbicide tolerance is a major trait, and maize, soybean and cotton, and also for, it is used for food use or feed use, or they are released for the cultivation. There are so much of adoption in more than 70 countries. 33 countries are adopting as direct, and others are importing the GM products. Like that, the 70 countries are using these GM crops. Besides that, the nuclear transfer, is there any possibility to tissue specific transfer of the particular gene? So they have gone, besides the nuclear genome, in the plant there are other two genomes, that is are present in chloroplast as well as in the mitochondria. So if it is in the plastids, if you are able to transfer a particular gene into the plastome, so they are able to express very well. As like that, the BT Cry2A is accumulated 46% more in plastome, so that some of the problems are also solved. So if it is a economical part is not the important one, for example, if it is of the pollen and other places, the plastids are not available in much, so that the gene flow is also eliminated. Besides that, you can express in a better way, but there are some challenges also. Only in the Solanaceous family, the plastome based transformation is perfected, and other crops it is not very well standardized. Besides that, there are thousands of plastomes are present, and the homoplasmic condition to bring out, so it is a challenging one. And next to that, they are able to go for, instead of the transgenesis, instead of taking from other, is it possible to transfer from a particular plant to plant? So the same thing, the native gene itself cloned and then transformed. Okay, from the plant itself, they are, instead of crossing, they are able to transfer at a transform at a precise location, so that you can produce the cisgenic GE crops. So like that, the one of the important example is potato. So in that, we are eating the chips. So in that, there is a browning occurs. So the anti-browning occurs, and also it reduces the acrylamide deposition in that. So that potato is approved for commercialization. So that is the innate potato by cisgenesis, by transferring same genes present in potato itself. And besides that, the people, instead of changing the DNA, is there any possibility to do the interference in the RNA? So they called it as RNA interference. So the post-translational modifications is prevented, so that we are able to get the organisms which are feeding on the plant get disturbed. So like that, they are able to make the RNAi, so which are not expressed. So their metabolic pathway are not functional. So there is a down regulation of a particular gene, so that the damage caused by the herbivore is also reduced. So this is one of the approach. It is a good one. In the corn, they have combined the BT protein and the RNAi approach. You can see in this graph. So when you combine that, there is a good spectacular events that are able to reduce the root grub damage. So like that, there are many type of studies are going on. But here, the one of the challenges, the RNAi is not a complete, it may vary depending upon the particular stage of a plant and how the dsRNA is present in a particular plant, or double-stranded RNA which is present, that is a stable molecule, and how they are able to be present in what quantity in a particular tissue or what stage. So that makes the the challenging one to create the normal. Okay, so the next aspect, so is there any possibility to, instead of doing the random mutation with the help of the chemical mutagens or physical mutagens, is it possible to do a targeted mutation? So in that, they introduce the multiple mutations. So instead of a mutation breeding with the chemical mutagen, it is a laborious. Everybody, I think some of the breeders are sitting in the audience. I am able to see Dr. Santa and others, and just they know that mutation breeding, how they are able to create a variation. So with the help of the chemical or with the help of the gamma rays, and in that, the genome editing is one of the important one where you can create a mutation. So targeted mutation or gene insertions and the replacements can be done. And in that, there are different types of methods. Now they are improved. One is the CRISPR-Cas gene editing, then base editing and the prime editing. So you are able to target a particular location of the particular gene. You disturb that gene so that it is mutated. So you will get a favorable allele for that. So this CRISPR-Cas9, now the gene edited plants, just same plant, if it is a rice plant itself, that particular gene, you identify that and you disturb them, because of the mutation created in that, you are getting a desirable trait. So in that, the regularly interspread short palindromic repeats are able to cut the double side, that is this sequence specific nucleases are used, so they are able to cleave the both the strands, you can see here. And after the cleaving, so you can make the insertion of the various type of sequences. Their own sequences are disturbed, or you can also insert the foreign DNA sequences. And because of the non-homologous enjoining, so that leads to the mutation present in that. So particular gene is knocked out, whereas in the RNAi, so it is suppressed. So their expression pattern is reduced. Whereas here, the whole gene is knocked out. Or you can go for the homology dependent repair. That is the homology what you are inserting. So the DNA is able to repair, and then the complementary DNA get joined, so that they are able to get the gene replacement also possible with the help of the CRISPR-Cas. Okay, so like that, the partivirus resistance is present in that. In the case of the cucumber, it is well proven, just a single nucleotide polymorphism. If you are seeing in one of the gene called the ELF4E, that is a transcription factor, and that factor, if you are disturbing them, the progenies, they tested in T3 generation, that gives the immunity to the cucumber vine yellowing virus. then yellow mosaic zucchini virus, papaya ring spot mosaic virus, all three viruses which are present in the cucumber, they are able to modify with just a disturbance. For example, if you know everybody the beta thalassemia disease, because of the inhuman, because of the one single nucleotide polymorphism, there is a variation between a normal person and a patient. Okay, like that, here you are creating a variation with the SNP. Because of that, it gives resistant to putty virus. Similarly, you can do it for grain yield. Some of the negative regulators, if you are able to knock out, so what we can do, if the negative regulators are knocked out, you will get a positive yield. Like that, they are able to regulate the grain number, grain size, grain weight by making the mutations in that, and the dense erect panicles and larger grain size and the grain number is also increased, so they are able to get the good yield. Similarly, the even the wild crop, you can make it into a cultivable crop. Wild crop may have a very good desirable trait, but they may not be compatible with the normal one. So in that case, you are making the wild crop itself, that trait are completely modified, and then you can reverse the wild plant into a new crop. So that is possible. For example, if it is as Solanum sesembrifolium and the Solanum pimpinellifolium, the fruit size is very small. Whereas if you are increasing the fruit size or fruit weight, so it can be treated as like tomato with all kind of qualities resistant to variant type of stresses. So this is also possible with the help of the new genome editing technologies. As like the CRISPR-Cas, the advancements is on base editing. So instead of making a double stranded cut, with the help of the nickase enzyme, when a single strand is cut and also a base pair alone is modified, just only one substitution of C to T with the help of the enzyme called the cytidine deaminase enzyme, so that is able to convert the C to T, so you are able to change, instead of C, the T is inserted into that. Because of that, you know that one base pair change, it changes the codon, and because of the codon change, the amino acid may be modified and there is a variation in the or disturbance in the particular genome sequence. Same thing, G to A substitution with the help of a specific nickase enzyme. Then the third technology is, instead of single base editing, they are able to make the engineered prime RNA, that is the PEG RNA, that makes the editing in the target site where the Cas9 cut one strand instead of the two strand, here only one strand, and that PEG RNA give the additional RNA molecules so that the new edited sequence are present in that, that doesn't have the particular expression. So the nucleotides varies, so the amino acids vary, so there is a possibility for mutation. So the CRISPR-Cas9, or with the single base pair base editing, or with the help of the PEG RNA, so particular sequence is edited for a longer period, only at the one strand, not at the two strand as like CRISPR-Cas. So these are the recent advancements in the genome editing or gene editing technologies, and already I explained this prime editing. So based on that, the many products now, they have the increased oil content or drought or salt tolerance in case of the soybean, or with the delayed flowering time, or the waxy corn, and the white button mushroom is a classical example with the anti-browning properties. They knock out a polyphenol oxidase gene so that they are able to get the anti-browning, that is the button mushroom with a good white color without browning. So this is the important technology. Now many of the labs in India are working on the various type of traits in various crops with the genome editing technology, and in CPMB also more than 7 or 8 projects are going in the CRISPR edited plants. And all these things, whether it may be a transgenesis or cisgenesis or gene edited plants, so various things are important, because so we have to see the risk which are assessed. As like in crop breeding, we have to testing under the various environment and what happens to that, and how the environmental and the food safety are present. So, and we have to see the non-target effect also, and is there any changes in the resistant evolution, etc. For all these things, now the basic science is also advanced. Instead of seeing a single gene by gene, now it is possible to entire genome as a holistic one, and many crops, the diversity panels are associated, and then India is also part of the rice, tomato, mango, and also ikrisat, chickpea, like that. There are so many plant genomes, they have the sequenced one, so that there are so many crops are sequenced, and there are so many papers on that. And next to that, now the genomic sequencing is also becoming more important with the help of the newer technologies like next generation sequencing. Earlier, for the sequencing of the human genome, it takes more than 12 years for a particular draft sequence. But now, if you are just within a 12 month, you can do 10 or 15 accessions of the same crop. So it is possible with the help of the Illumina reversible terminator sequencing, as well as the recent one with a larger sequence of the PacBio. So they are able to cut the pieces of the DNA and then sequence them and then align them. So the bioinformatic work is done to assemble the scaffolds and annotate the particular genes present in that. There are so much of advancements occurs in this field. So this is also another area of recent technology, the next generation sequencing, the second generation, third generation. Now they are telling about fourth generation sequencing methods are improving. So like that, not only DNA, they are able to go for the RNA sequencing, like a transcriptomics, and also the proteins, proteomics, like that. There are so many digestions, genome sequence are available. 300K genome is available, like that. The chickpea, now they have a 250 genome sequencing, like that. There are many projects in various type of plant genome. So they are doing a lot of work, not only in genomics, the transcriptomics, proteomics, and the metabolomics. So there are different approaches are used, and they study the DNA level, RNA level, protein level, and the metabolite level to see the responses for various type of stresses. And is it possible to combine all these things? Now the new area of science is improving, that is called synthetic biology. So is it possible to combine all these sciences? And are you able to create a variation with a different type? So they already proved in E. coli as well as in yeast, they are able to create a synthetic yeast or synthetic E. coli. So like that, is it possible to create a particular organism by combining a desirable traits? So they are able to go for that. Or we can just use it for various type of responses, which one gives, so you can use it. So not only on crop plants, so they also study with the various type of associated organisms. So it may be a insects or it may be a plant pathogens. So they have the very big impact, as like in insects. So they have called the 5K genome project. That is the 5,000 insects. They sequenced already 1K transcriptome. That is the one kite project. So they have the transcriptome data of 1,000 insects. So like that, they are able to correlate various type, and they go for various type of management measures are useful for the favorable thing. And they also form a consortium called the Insect Genetic Technology Research Coordination Network. So in that also, the molecular diagnostics are improved with the help of the molecular tools. You know that RT-PCR is the now for COVID. So like that, for here also in plant viruses and various kind of RNA viruses are done with the help of the RT-PCR. Or there are many newer technologies with the one chip, you are able to detect the various type of organism pathogens in a single chip. So like that, the diagnostic method also advanced. They are very much important even nowadays for the to arrest the quarantine pest, the invasive pest, which are entering into various countries now because of the global economy, and there is an exchange of the trade, and there are a lot of technologies improvement, starting from the initial selection up to the transgenesis, cisgenesis, or genome editing, or you can take the various type of sciences. There are a lot of improvements, but in all cases, the government is also having the regulation both at the local level, like Institutional Biosafety Committee, and also the regulations at the national level, like Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation or Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, like that. There are so many committees. They are watching, and every 6 months you have to submit a report. What type of variations in the recombinant DNA technology or gene editing you are able to do, you have to submit a report and see that. And all the only after seeing the benefits, so they are able to release it. So the benefits of the technology and see the socio-economic impact. It is not a panacea for all the trade, all the things. You have to see that which is not able to do by the conventional one. So you can go for any kind of approach, and at the same time you have to see environmental safety and food safety. So, and besides that, the building a public confidence in biotechnology is most important. So you are the great ambassadors of the teachers. So through you, so the public confidence building to the students or to the public can be made. So this is the most important one. Anybody can say the negative effects of biotechnology very easily, but telling the positive side or what, how the technology is important and how the, what are the improvements made, what are the variations present, and we have to educate them, then only the people are get more knowledge. And you know that in the COVID now, there are so much of views, but WHO and the our ICMR views are alone taken by the state government. So like that, you have to see the build the confidence in biotechnology. And as like everybody taking about the allopathy, now they are able to, with the help of a single person, they are able to say that Siddha medicine is also good for the COVID. Same like that, we have to build the confidence among the people so that they are able to have the various kind of adoption of the various technologies that only serves the society. So with these, the various trends which are present in the agriculture biotechnology, I'm able to give you a slight picture. Besides that, there are a lot of variations present in the microorganisms, pathogens, etc. I'm not covering that. I hope I finished in a perfect time to have an interaction for few questions. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity for the patient hearing also. Thank you.
Sir, thank you.
Thank you, sir.